We are live. Please start presenting.
Okay. Good morning. It gives me immense pleasure in welcoming all of you to the Hirak Jayanti Mahotsav 2020. Yesterday, with the blessings of Almighty, we raised the curtains of opening ceremony as the gateway to the initiation of our scientific program. Myself, Vaidya Sushant Sood, Head and Associate Professor in the Department of Agat Tantra, Shri Gulabpur Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, Gujarat Ayurved University, Jamnagar. I feel really privileged and honored to welcome you all for this special day. In the history of Shri Gulabpur Ayurved Mahavidyalaya, as the entire Ayurved family is connected online in this tormenting time of COVID-19 with a mantra of stay safe and stay connected. I am delighted to host the online expert talk on the theme Ayur Vision, Future Vision of Ancient Science. Ayur Vision has been established with the sole objective of providing an authentic and genuine knowledge thrust to unravel age-old science of Ayurveda. We have tried to bring together best from the either sides of ancient sciences of East and modern perspective from the West without compromising on the basic principles of Ayurveda. Friends, today with us, we have a high level government personality, a well-known administrator and academician, and a renowned practitioner, all under one umbrella. And I am swayed that the presence of such eminent personalities among us will contribute to the value of this event deliberation. So without further ado, let me call upon in charge principal and organizing chairman of Hirak Jayanti Mahotsav 2020 to kindly introduce and welcome our esteemed guest and highlight the event details. I request Vaidya Arpan Bhatt sir to please welcome and give a brief introduction about this event. Sir.
Namaste and very good morning and warm welcome to all the distinguished speakers of this session, Vaidya Rajesh Kotecha ji, Vaidya Anup Thakur ji and Vaidya Upendra Dikshit ji. I would like to in brief say about this session. Actually what we had planned was full day sessions on these topics. But as we know that owing to this pandemic, we were not in a position to make this event happen physically. So we decided to go online. And when we went online, what we decided is these are the three burning issues of today. The first, that in this condition of pandemic, how to control the mindset of the people, because you can still increase the immunity through some drugs, through food, through some exercises, but what about the mind? How can we think about the mind? How can we tame the mind in this condition? That was number one issue. Number two issue was boosting up the immune system of the people. So Ayurveda has rasayan, which has been stated to rejuvenate a person. So definitely it would be working on immune system, but how and what does it work with? That was the second issue we wanted to deal with. And the third, which is a question which is always asked about Ayurveda, and that is whether Ayurveda works in an emergency condition. So whether it works or not, and if it works, how and up to what level it works. So we tried to address these three issues in one session, which is going to happen right now here. We have three very eminent speakers and distinguished, knowledgeable persons of Ayurveda with us today. One, the first and foremost of them all, none other than the secretary of Ministry of Ayush, Padma Shri Vaidya Rajesh Kutejaji. Okay, right now he is in the role of an administrator, but basically he is a clinician. He is a wonderful orator as well. He has got some publications in his name, and one important publication which draws my vision towards is the concept of atattva bhinivesha in Ayurveda. That is, how can you think about the mind and its turmoil and the hallucinations it produces, and how can you deal with in Ayurveda? And therefore, what we thought was that majority of us have heard Vaidya Rajesh Kutejaji as an administrator, as secretary of Ayush. We would love, like to listen him as a clinician who would talk about the subject on he, on in which he has an authority. So our first speaker of the day will be Padma Shri Vaidya Rajesh Kutejaji, who is secretary of Ayush. He is the ex-vice chancellor of this university, and above all, he happens to be an alumnus of this Gulabpurva Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya, where today he will be delivering the lecture. Our second speaker of the day, Vaidya Anup Thakurji, who happens to be the in-charge vice chancellor of this university and director of Institute for Postgraduate Teaching and Research in Ayurveda, which happens to be a very renowned institute so far as the College of Ayurveda in India is concerned, and of course abroad as well. He has so many accolades to his name. He is an internationally reputed and well-known figure in the field of Ayurveda. Everybody knows him, like, you know, introducing him is like showing a torchlight towards the sun. So the second speaker of the day we have, and who will be speaking about Vyadik Shamatva and Rasayan Chikitsa, will be Vaidya Anup Thakurji, our own. And finally, the third speaker of the day of this session will be Vaidya Upendra Dukshitji, who happens to be the chief physician of Dikshit Ayurveda Goa. He is in both, like he is a well-known clinician as well as he is well-known academician with around 25 years of experience in both. And he happens to be exponing, he has got two publications in his name. The first one happens to be Flux of Existence, that is Ayurvedic Vision Study of Panchamahabhuta and Brahma. That means the main base of Ayurveda from where it comes up. And second, he is a co-author of Science and Technology in Ancient India, section on Ayurveda. So, we have got three eminent personalities who are going to give justification to their subjects, and the subjects with which Dr. Dikshit will be dealing is Atyayik Chikitsa in Ayurveda. So, with these initial remarks, I hope you will enjoy our this academic session, and wishing you once again a very good morning. I'll hand over the microphone to Vaidya Sushantji for further proceedings. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir, for unfolding the event details in a very nutshell. And I think we are ready to move ahead with our scientific program. A mentor who always emphasized on creating a new outlook, developing a scientific attitude, values, and is truly an instrument of change. Yes, I'm talking about our very own Padma Shri Vaidya Rajesh Kutejaji. Here, I take this opportunity to call upon Padma Shri Vaidya Rajesh Kutejaji, sir, Secretary, Ministry of Ayush, Government of India, New Delhi, who, amid his busy schedule and responsibilities, has agreed to dignify and magnify our online session. I request sir to deliver his talk on the topic Janpada Dhwans and Manochikitsa. I welcome you, sir. Please.
Namaskar to all. Thank you so much for inviting me, dear Professor Thakur ji, Professor Upendra Dixit ji, Professor Arpan Bhatt ji, the team GAU, team Gulakur Bhaived Mahavidyalay, and all participants, all students, all faculty. My namaskaram to all. For me, it's an honor and privilege to be here at this platform of Hirak Jayanti Mahotsav of Gulakur Bhaived Mahavidyalay, my own college where I studied, where I started my career. And then the same campus where I went back again as a vice chancellor to head the institution. So I'm definitely emotionally attached also, and I feel privileged. At this occasion, at this juncture, before I start my speech, I want to convey my gratitude to my gurus who has taught me into this college, particularly Professor Mansingh Gohil ji and Professor Notani ji. Both of them have been able to shape my personality and actually to help me shape me, what I am now. So I have to remember them. And I will have a presentation, small presentation that I want to share. And first of all, excuse me. So first of all, I would like to share what Ministry of Ayush is doing for this pandemic in a very quick snapshot. And then I'll go to the subject, Janapadodhvans. I don't need to explain what is Janapadodhvans, but I need to share some of the activities what Ministry of Ayush has taken up, which is very impressive. So I want to share my screen, and Sushant, please confirm whether my screen is visible or not. Is okay, Sushant?
Yes,
is
sir.
My screen visible?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Visible.
Okay. So what I want to mention, as I said, that Ministry of Ayush, something about, you know, about COVID. This is a dashboard I'm sharing of WHO as on in the afternoon of 29th June. You can see it is all over the world except China. We don't know about China because, you know, we are aware that they hide a lot of things, so we don't know what is the situation there. But basically, Sushant, please mute your mic. So basically, more than 1 crore people are affected, and every day there is more than 175,000 cases coming up, and roughly 500,000 deaths are there. In India also, as on 26th or 29th June, you can see now the figure is changed. So this is just a snapshot. When you look at the Ministry of Ayush, you know, we have taken up so many activities, public health delivery system. We have issued clinical guidelines, prophylaxis studies we have initiated. Industry support was there. Integration, backward and forward integration was done. There is a lot of activity in research. Public communications are also there. So there are different support systems we have initiated, even including human resource support from Ayush sector to the mainstream health services. So when you look at that, we can see that it is like a reduced disease burden from prophylaxis and from therapeutics, or increased support mechanism through health system with resources, or for non-COVID health delivery, like Dhanvantri Rath in Jamnagar. This is a wonderful example, or Dhanvantri Rath in Ahmedabad. This is a wonderful example of support for non-COVID health system delivery. Then we have interdisciplinary AYUSH R&D task force, and this task force is chaired by Vice Chairman of UGC, Professor Patwardhanji, and it has representation of CSIR, ICMR, DBT, AIIMS, WHO, academicians, practitioners, DGs of research councils, national institutes. It has delivered a lot. And as a matter of fact, you can see that we had initiated a lot of independent researches. We have issued a lot of clinical guidelines, protocols, several protocols of study designs. We have been identified, able to identify drug candidates, strategic collaborations, multicentric trials, prophylaxis trials, therapeutic trials, app-based study, health system component, study with WHO, study with Tata Institute of Social Sciences, study with PHFI, cloud-based studies, platforms, lot of things happened. So the idea was to bring down the number of infections, or if at all somebody is infected, we can help them to stay asymptomatic and not to go further into complicated stage. This was the idea. And now we are in the middle of something that I want to mention. This is another activity we have introduced, this AYUSH Sanjeevani app. If you have not downloaded that, please download it and give us a feedback. It is a never happened kind of study, which is an impact assessment of AYUSH intervention for COVID mitigation across the country. We have more than 40 lakh data already. Data set is available. We have collected through this app. And if you have not downloaded this, please download and help us to let Government of India know how AYUSH interventions has helped you or your community. So this is another study. Then also I mentioned that with COVID barriers, we have supported Government of India with more than 800,000 qualified registered students. So we have extended that support also. Then now we come to subject. I wanted to just introduce in 3-4 minutes what we are doing, just for the dissemination of information. It is an issue because we have been facing a lot of crises, particularly first lockdown, sudden withdrawal of all activities, staying home, and after lockdown, unlock stress of either getting infected or economic stress, lot of kind of stress we are facing. And it is normal that this is a trauma for all of us. And it depends upon an individual capacity, individual aptitude, based on their prakriti or their susceptibility, or we call it like they have shat kriyakal, the level of their shat kriyakal, then they are affected with the disorder, or they have some pura rupa or some kind of accumulation of dosha. But basically for us, this is a very stressful event. So such kind of sudden stresses, we humans are vulnerable to succumb to such types of stresses. So I will not read out all these slides. I will suggest you to read out, because I will just speak about the concerned connected topic, and I'm not going to read everything. But I want to mention that there are some common reactions. In modern medicine, there is a specific term known as PTSD and post-traumatic stress disorder. So we are passing through this phase of trauma. So we are also susceptible to so many such cases of PTSD. And it changes the behavior, changes the pattern of a person, how he or she reacts to a certain kind of stressful situations. So we are facing this, and then what are the solutions from Ayurveda? When we talk about Ayurveda, there are a lot of possibilities. We know that we have this Prakriti Siddhanta, Prakriti principle, Vat Pitta Kapha, and our dominant Prakriti help us to react to such kind of situation. And we all know that our minor properties of our mind, that is chinta, udvega, or utsaha, or sukha, all those, if it is in balance, our prakriti stays in balance. And if it goes to vikruti, and then we get some kind of disorder. Here I want to mention about this very famous sutra. It is hita hitam sukham dukham ayustasya hita hitam manam cha tatsat yatvaktam ayu vredha sa uchate. So it is a general definition of Ayurveda, but then we have a lot of take home message from this sutra. Like we are supposed to stay hitayu and sukhayu, or achieve hitayu and sukhayu in our lives. And we are supposed to avoid the ahitayu and dukhayu in our lives. So these words, four words, hitayu, sukhayu, and ahitayu, dukhayu, has its actually meaning. It needs some explanation. So when we talk about hitayu, we are supposed to, you know, live hitayu, which is like responsible or right way to live. And responsible right way to live have an interpretation. Probably it is like responsibility to the self, responsibility to the family, responsibility to the community or society, to the nation, and to the mother nature or environment. So if we want to stay healthy, this is the first condition, that we have to be responsible to everything. And another is sukhayu, is like which gives us a happiness. And we have these definitions that the sukha sankhyakyam arogyam and vikaro dukham eva cha, means that if we are healthy, we are happy, or vice versa. So happiness and health, they are considered as, you know, synonym to each other. And the same antonym are that if we are not happy, we are stressed out, then we are ill. And that also, you know, causes ahitayu. So ahitayu, dukhayu should be avoided. How to do that? So as the message says, hitayu should be observed. It means that when we want to avoid the stress, and then when we to pass through this phase of pandemic, the first message is that all of us should practice hitayu, responsible way of life, responsible way to the mother nature, and sharing our happiness, sharing of what we have, social communication, good communication to the family, and so on. So this is very important to understand. We know that this monastery is so tapa parasparam vibrajet adhara deya bhavena tapta jas das dotavit. It means that basic concept of Ayurveda is that each individual is an integrated whole system, a total entity in relation to world around him. We call it like that Atmavat Sarva Bhuteshu, also there is another principle. Or we are the miniature replica of the universe. So we have a continuous interaction with the universe. And we need to understand that when we talk about the, you know, Mana Chikitsa, or when we specifically discuss about the Janapadodvans, and then the possibility of mental disorder. We all know that Ayurveda has a very integral understanding of mental health. Whatever we talk about the disease management, everywhere we have this component of mental health. It means that mental health is not a separate issue, but all of the diseases, everybody should be, you know, whenever we treat them, whenever we look at the health perspective, we need to look at their mind also. And that is why in basic, these three treatments, Sattva Vajaya is also mentioned in addition to Yukti Vyapasya and Devi Vyapasya. So Sattva Vajaya Chikitsa is not specific to mental health problems, but Sattva Vajaya Chikitsa is to be applied to everywhere. And that is very important factor I would like to mention. Significance of mind, you know, that Charaka says that who have his mind under control does not contract any disease, which is like, you know, a message that if we have our mind is in our control, then we don't indulge into the causative factors, and we understand the scenario. Like you can see some people reacts into stressful situation differently, and other people reacts differently. It is because of the mindset, because of the mind training, because of their experiences of the past, and that is very important. You can see that there is a popular experiment in animal studies that tolerance of the heat is to be studied under for the rats, that every day they are exposed to some kind of heat, and heat is to be increased every day. So their tolerance gets more and more, and at some point of time, they tolerate a heated plate, without reacting anything. So that is like a kind of a training to them. This kind of training is also possible for the mind, and we can be trained. There are different batteries, there are different methods that I'm going to explain to train our minds not to have a lot of exposure, not to have a lot of reaction to a routine type of stress, and not to have a bizarre reaction of our system to the different types of stress, particularly in the pandemic. So that is very important message and very important aspect of looking at that when we talk about Ayurvedic understanding of dealing with such types of stressful disorders. Also, Ayurveda says that most of our diseases, almost all, having psychosomatic nature. You know, in modern medicine, they don't believe everything is psychosomatic, but we, in Ayurveda, we have, because mind involvement is everywhere. So we believe that if mind is also taken into considerations, lot of disease intensity can be reduced. For example, we have this sattva rajas tamas understanding. So you can see that persons with having more sattva, they have more chance to heal, because they don't pay a lot of attention, they are not anxious, they are not stressful, and they get better, or they are not affected with the physical problems very much like as rajasic or tamasic people. So there's another understanding that we need to look at. So if we consider this pandemic situation and stress and mental disorder into the Satta Kriya Kal perspective, then you can relate this with Sanchaya, Prakopa, Prasara, Sthana Sanchaya, and Vyakta, and Vedavastha also. So as an Ayurvedic practitioner, all of us should look at these possibilities and should arrest further forward of disease progression in individual when we look at the individual. So that is also a very important aspect to understand. Ayurveda has a lot of understanding about the sleep, nidra, vyayama, or there are different aspects of mental health. No addiction is one of the important aspects of mental health. Ahar pachana, we always mention that we need to eat when the earlier taken food is digested, and agni should be optimized. So if our agni is optimized, then there is a less chance of reacting to such kind of stress, and be more chance of staying healthy. Same thing is with the normal nidra, sleep, or same chances is with the activity, positive activities of the day. We all know that yoga is a sister science of Ayurveda. So when we think of therapeutics in Ayurveda, we always look at possible therapeutics of yoga. So yoga abhyasa, pranayama, staying busy, staying with the family, hitayu practices like social life, family life, personal life, positively cultivating those aspects. Or if we are stressed into final situation, we need to look at that from a third person perspective so that we find some way. If we get stressed, and then it is our decision making capacity is compromised. So those aspects which we need to see, and in Ayurveda, all these things are very detailed, explained in very detail. When we look at the symptoms, there are a lot of symptoms, physical symptoms or cognitive symptoms, particularly, if somebody is affected with this kind of stress, sudden stress, and then they have different types of symptoms. So as a physician, we need to understand whether they are real physical problems or it is coming out of this crisis. And then we can offer them the treatment. If it is coming out of the crisis, we need to address, plan the treatments in a way, immediate treatment and long-term treatment. Immediate treatment could be possibly some pharmacotherapeutic intervention of Medhya Rasayana, but then long-term treatment is counseling, sattvavajaya chikitsa, or correcting to diets and correcting and counseling them for the hitayu, etc. are more important. Then there are some behavioral symptoms, there are some emotional system symptoms. We can always look at those aspects when we see a person suffering from these stressful disorders. Also, I have compiled these system-wise clinical conditions, for long-term exposure to stresses. That also a physician should take into consideration. For example, if somebody is suffering with sudden crisis of skin health, more acne and more pruritus kind of thing, then we need to look at this possibility of, you know, this pandemic and stressful situation for that particular person. So in addition to the twacha chikitsa, if we add some medhya rasayana, it helps. So those kind of approach I want to suggest. I mentioned about the Devya Parsha Satvaja and the Active Vikti Parsha Chikitsa, and all of that has a very, very important role into the managing of such kind of disorders. And we all know about Devya Parsha Chikitsa. Actually, I believe that Devya Parsha Chikitsa is outside of the domain of Ayurvedic practitioner. This is to be given to the spiritual healers, and there is a science behind it. But we should not venture into everything. As an Ayurvedic practitioner, we should put more attention to Satvajaya Chikitsa and Yukti Vyaparsaya Chikitsa, I believe. And Devaparsaya Chikitsa should be left to the spiritual healers or people who offer these such kind of therapies, hypnotherapist hai either, or Reiki therapist hai. And there are so many mantra chikitsa, mani dharan, etc. All there are so some or the other science now, and we need to explore those possibilities with the specific expertise. As far as Satvajaya Chikitsa is concerned, you know, we can relate it with the psychotherapy of modern medicine or modern psychology. Psychotherapy is very highly structured, whereas Satvajaya Chikitsa has more scope, is more bigger umbrella than psychotherapy. So we need to look at this possibility of Ashwasana, replacement of emotions, psychoshock therapies, or in Atattva Vyari Chikitsa, they have mentioned about dhyana or sadhana or aushadhi or medhya rasayana, etc. That also should be looked at. Yukti Vyapara Chikitsa, we all know, is the pharmacotherapeutic intervention, and it could be Samana Chikitsa or Shodhana Chikitsa or both or combination. As of now, Samana Chikitsa is more practically applicable and accessible for the patients. I already mentioned about psychotherapy. When we look at this Gita, Mahabharata is a great textbook of psychopathology, and Gita is a great treatise of psychotherapy. So I would suggest all of the listeners to look at this possibility of understanding how to deal with psychiatric ailments, not only during this COVID crisis, but otherwise into your practices, and look at Gita, how Gita is offering so much of simple solutions to psychiatric problems, be it a minor psychiatric illnesses, anxiety or obsessive compulsive or major psychiatric problems. So this is wonderful that I want to mention that. I want to recommend this book, Integrating Traditional Healing Practices into Counseling and Psychotherapy. And that is a very wonderful book. And it talks about the guru-shishya relationship, and then how a guru takes a student through an experiential journey of self-exploration with an aim to liberate the disciple from all sufferings. So it means that all of us should have, you know, some guru in our life. A guru means that not like that the guru is giving you guru mantra and you are you know, doing puja of guru every day like a god. That is not what I wanted to convey. I want to give an example. In the beginning, I mentioned about two of my gurus in my life, like Professor Mansingh Goyalji and Professor Lotaniji, like guru. And then those gurus actually take students through an experiential journey of self-exploration. So that is very important for whether we are an Ayurvedic practitioner or not. Or this should be disseminated to the patients that, you know, that please consider to have, you know, some mentor into your life who can take you to the experiential journey, who has great experiences of the life. That is also a kind of a treatment for such kind of disorders or some solution. Satvajaya Chikitsa in Charak Sanhita Chikitsa Sthana, in Purattattva Vinayasa is mentioning, is a Jnana Vijnana Dhirya Smriti Samadhi Bihi, is a one capsule of or one sentence of the treatment course or action. And Jnana, we know that Jnana is like a spiritual knowledge about the life, and Vijnana is knowledge about the material thing of the life. And Dhairya is one of the important aspects of basic understanding of Hitayu. Smriti is the reviving of the knowledge, and Samadhi. Samadhi is not like sitting in a posture and trying to meditate. Samadhi is something abstaining from overindulgence to materialistic world. So If you overindulge, we know that ati pravritti is one of the basic cause of all diseases. So avoiding ati pravritti is also kind of samadhi. That is what we need to look at that perspective. Then there are certain food, different varieties of food also help us into, you know, getting better. We all know that food is also medicine. So we need to look at that possibility of healing through food for the psychiatric illnesses or for stress relieving. But I want to alert, I want to warn that when you use food, you please make sure that your patients are not become bulimic. So don't talk too much about food. Educate them about varieties of food and educate them about the importance of food, fresh food, etc. But patients should not understand that eating too much will help my stress get relieved. Then they will become bulimic. So that's also one kind of a possibility. Then another therapeutic is Shirodhara. We all know about Shirodhara, how it helps. As far as the Ministry of Ayush is concerned, we have, you know, lot of contribution to mental health. In NIMHANS, we have a collaborating center, or de-addiction center, dedicated de-addiction center, CCRS. In National Institute of Ayurveda, there is a de-addiction center. And then classical formulations, mental health, there are publications, and there are publications for children, geriatric population. All these things are there, that I want to suggest these resources. And there are some good research publications like generation of evidence on clinical safety and efficacy of classical Ayurvedic formulations, including Methya Rasayana. And then the generalized anxiety disorder, there's a study on GAD, and it is very wonderful study on Ashwagandha and Madhuparani with Shirodhara and with Kirubala Tail, or Ashwagandha and Madhuparani in the management of Manodvega, or clinical vision of Brahmi, Grit and Jyotishmati in the management of cognitive definition of children, deficit in children, or clinical safety of selected Ayurvedic formulations as Jarsayana in apparently healthy elderly person, or Chyavanprash. So, you know, you can see that I'm going through these, you know, important resources for dealing with such situation. We have a lot of evidences, and that is what I wanted to convey. Then there is a clinical trial was conducted on Antarctic expedition members. And this is very important. It was done with the help of DRDO, and it is a very well designed study, and it is also having a great outcome, and there are a lot of publications. Also, double blind control study on the role of Brahmadi Yoga, having Mandukparani, Jatamansi, Pushta, Sarpagandha, Vacha, etc., and Tagara. And it is having a control trial with clopromazine versus placebo. So it's also very important, a very interesting study. Or anti-anxiety effect of a compound, double-blind sequential crossover study, or role of Ayurvedic drug Brahmi in the management of senile dementia. These are only some few. There are few hundred publications. A double-blind study conducted with Mandukparani on 30 children with MR. So in a collaborative manner, CCRS has also developed Ayush Manas for mental retardation. And with the help of AIMS, New Delhi, and BHU, and in Kolkata, we have developed Ayush Rasayana A and B. Also, this is a very good Medhya Rasayana. Then these are the guidelines, either the based dietary and lifestyle advocacy for mental health and psychiatric disorders, or training module for geriatric health and healthcare, or such kind of resources. At the end, I want to mention about Achara Rasayana. When we talk about this Sattvavajya Chikitsa, Achara Rasayana is also part of it, is a component of it. And then there are three parts: personal behavior, social behavior, or Sattva Ahara and Vihara. We all know about that. I already discussed about that. And there are some details about this ethical conduct. And this ethical conduct helps our mind to become strong and not to react to extreme types of stresses. Possibly we are, you know, through practice of Achara Rasayana, we develop our capability to deal with stress in a better way. So our reaction to stress becomes minimal through the practice of Achara Rasayana. Dinacharya also is very important to help our mind to get, you know, trained for not to react to too much of stress. You know, mental health perspective, protective facts, and then those we know, I discussed a lot of them, but these are the details about being in a good physical health, eating a balanced diet, regular exercise, freedom to play indoors and outdoors, feeling loved, trusted, understood, valued and safe, feeling important, you know, or making other persons important in our life, our around us also, help us to get a kind of happiness or sukha. So those kind of practices are what I'm trying to convey. So I mentioned about sister sciences yoga. So we need to look at the possibilities of yoga also in our practices. Effect of yoga on stress management in healthy adults, a review. Yoga and stress among healthy adults, a systematic review. There are so many reviews available on internet and on PubMed index. So I want to quote this at the end about the quote of Buddha, Lord Buddha. He said, the secret of health for both mind and body is not to mourn for the past, not to worry about the future, not to anticipate the future, but to live the present moment wisely and earnestly. So this is Lord Buddha's statement. And eyes are useless when the mind is blind. This is another quote I want to mention. Thank you so much. Namaskar.
Thank you so much, sir, for your valuable thoughts and especially your inspiring talk, for giving us an insight about the role of Manochikitsa during this time of COVID-19. So you have highlighted some of the very important views regarding the different startups and the initiations taken by Ministry of Ayush, and we are really hopeful and sure about the initiatives and the startups being taken to the further level of the peak. You talked about some of the very important points related to the mental health trauma. You emphasized about the PTSD and showed us the significance and importance of the mind in Ayurveda, the role of Man, specifically in the relation of psychosomatic disorders and the relation during this COVID-19 situation. We are really thankful to you, sir, to show us the different studies which are happening around in and around the globe. And I'm hopeful that all of us who have joined here will get an insight view of talks and the thoughts you have shared with us. Thank you so much, sir. Sir, we'll be having some of the questions which will be taken after the third expert speaker talk about his topic. So if it is possible, I want you to be with us during the whole session so that we can share some of the question answers with the respective dignitaries in the form of guest lectures. So I request you to, sir, to be with us and remain with us throughout the session so that we can have the discussion on the questions. Moving on with our second guest, I am pleased to have the chance to introduce our next guest speaker, who has been one of the main proponents of this program and truly stands out in the field of Ayurveda as an eminent academician and flag bearer of this esteemed university. I request Vaidya Anoop Thakur, Vice Chancellor of Gujarat Ayurveda University, Director IPGTNRA, Jamnagar, to deliver his talk on the topic Vyadhi Kshamatva and Rasayan Chikitsa. I request Vaidya Anoop Thakur, sir, to deliver his talk. Sir.
Thank you for a very nice introduction. Our Honorable Secretary, sir, Vaidya Rajesh Kotecha-ji, Vaidya Upendra Dikshit-ji, Dr. Arpan Bhatt-ji, and all the organizers and dear friends who has joined today with us. We are really blessed that we got our Secretary, sir, as an academician and clinician today with us on this occasion of the 75th year of the institute on the Diamond Jubilee. We really are thankful to him that he blessed us on today. He spare this much time with us despite of his very busy schedule nowadays. So with that, I start with my topic. Actually, I am Dr. Sushant. It is visible.
Sir, it is getting shared, sir. Just a minute. Yes, sir. It is visible, sir. Please make it on slideshow, sir. It will. Yes, sir. Please. Thank you.
Thank you. So today I have been given the responsibility to talk about rasayana, and just a minute, I will. Rasayan, Vedic Shamatva and Rasayan Chikitsa. You know, a very important thing. Is a Vedic Shamatva and Rasayan nowadays, as far as the COVID pandemic is concerned. Our own very beloved Prime Minister, PM Narendra Modi ji, shares in very beginning in the March that Ayurvedic formula is very good, and Ayurvedic drugs are very good to enhance your immunity and use that. He advised seven steps to save yourself from the COVID. One of the step was immunity boosting through this Ayush drugs, and that shows the importance. Actually, Ministry of Ayush really worked wonderful, and this impact has been created, and everybody is getting benefited due to this nectar of Ayurveda or wisdom of the Ayurveda. And our PM Modi ji endorsed it very well, and even he shared it with globally. There was a statement that medical supply and Ayurveda, Modi Trump talk ways to tackle COVID-19 crisis. This was the news, and it was shared by the Ministry of Ayush also. So Vedic Shamatva and Rasayana, particularly immunity, is very much important today. And again, Modi ji told, and in WHO also officially advised, that coronavirus is a new reality, and we will have to learn to live with it. It's not going to vanish overnight, and there is no drug till date, no vaccine till date, to cure the coronavirus or to check the coronavirus infection. And hence, importance of the immunity, increases in many folds in these conditions. And it has been told by our own Prime Minister that lockdown 4 will be totally different, and we'll have to learn to live with COVID. Everybody is saying this, even the ICMR and every leading institute in the country who are related with the COVID, they are saying this, that we have to learn to live with COVID. In this situation, how Ayurveda can help? So we have to learn to live with coronavirus, and then in that situation, boost your immune system is the only way out with us to cope with that. And to boost the immune system, Ayurveda can be the best option amongst all options available today for the boosting the immunity system. That's what I believe. And it has been known as a Vyadhik Shamatva since long in the Ayurveda. Vyadhik Shamatva has been given important, and it has been described in detail in Ayurveda. We will see in the forthcoming slides. The balance between infection and immunity is very much important. You have an infection, you have a virulence factor, everything is there. But if you have a good immunity, then it will check. There will be a balance. There will be no disease if you have provided you have a good immunity. But if your immunity comes down due to any reasons, then infection will increase, and then you are susceptible to infection, and you may succumb to the infection, and it may harm you. So if you have a good you know, immune system, you are going to survive, you need not to worry. But if there is immunodeficiency, then we have to think about. So we have to maintain the balance, we have to maintain the homeostasis, and we'll be able to maintain the immunity. And for manipulating this equation means, you know, there is equation that infection, virulence of the number, and host resistance. If both are equal or even host resistance is more, then, you know, infection will be checked and there will be no issue. And so we have to focus on that. Until a vaccine is available, our immune systems will need to adapt unaided to COVID-19. A healthy lifestyle helps one's immune system to be in the best shape possible to tackle pathogens, but it is better to stop them entering the body in the first place. Means it is, you know, always has been said that prevention is better than cure, and immunity is the way for the prevention. And very importantly, you know, Louis Pasteur, very well-known scientist, has given the statement that germ is nothing, the terrain is everything. This is very much important, and this exactly depicts the principles of the Ayurveda. You know, Ayurveda has said for any disease, for anything, four factors are required. Rutu, Kshetra, Ambu, Beech. Means if there is a seed, that is a beech, we consider here as infection, can be a viral, can be a bacterial, whatever it can be. If it enters in your body, then it requires other three factors. Once beech is also, whether it is an infection is very strong or not, that also important. If very, very fertile seeds are not there, then infection won't get spread and there won't be a disease. But we consider that beech means seed, infection is very strong and it's a viral load is high and everything is there. Then other three factors plays a very major role. You know, first is the season, whether the season is favorable or not. Like this season, spread is in comparison to your monsoon or in comparison to cold season, there are less chances of the spread in this season. Then kshetra, field, how your body is, this is very much important, and their immunity or Vedic Samatva comes in between. Important is your field, means how your body reacts to it, how it protects itself from that infection or whatever disease has come. That makes a lot of difference. And there the Ayurveda comes. We can make a strong our field, our kshetra, that is our body, by enhancing the immunity or Vedic Shamatva. And then nourishing factors means when you get disease, then what you take, how you eat, how you sleep, what you are doing, how you are behaving, that makes a lot of difference. That may enhance the infection, that may check the infection also. Suppose you are taking proper rest, you are sleeping well, you are having the good food and proper food. Not good food means in the reference of the disease, means in the context of the disease, we have to consider the good food, the light, the hot, and easily digestible food should be taken. All these things, all these factors plays a major role. So only infection cannot do anything. All these things are important, and so need not to worry. We have a lot many tools. Once even there is infection, we have a lot many tools to manipulate the things, to manage the things, to treat the things. So immunity in Ayurveda, what it is? Broadly known as a Vyadhik Shamatva, described in Ayurveda, immunity can be considered under this Vyadhik Shamatva. Vyadhik Shamatva means the capacity of body to act against disease, which means it can prevent all as well as fight against disease. Protecting force behind individual's health is Vyadhik Shamatva. So Chakrapani says that Vyadhik Shamatva is a Vyadhi Balavirodhitvam व्याधि उत्पाद प्रतिबंधकत्वम इति व्यावत. दिस चक्रपाणी हैज यू नो कमेंटेड ऑन द वैदिक समत्व दैट व्हाट वैदिक समत्व इज. सो इट हैज यू नो गिवन टॉस टू वर्ड्स दैट व्याधि बल विरोधित्वम एंड व्याधि उत्पाद प्रतिबंधकत्वम. व्हाट इज व्याधि बल विरोधित्व विरोधत्वम दैट इज बायोलॉजिकल डिफेंसिव पावर of the body to fight against the ongoing afflicted disease. Once you have a disease, when there is infection and what your body reacts and what your body, your immunity fights with that is vyadhi bal virodhatva and vyadhi utpad pratibandhakatvam to prevent the future development of the disease means to prevent your body from get disease, to get infected. That is vyadhi utpad pratibandhakatvam. So vyadhi kshamatva can be divided into vyadhi bal virodhitva and vyadhi utpad pratirodhakatva. So vyadhi bal virodhitva is the capacity of the body to fight against the manifested disease, and vyadhi utpad pratirodhakatva is the capacity of body to not allow to produce disease or pathogenesis, occurrence of the disease. So overall vyadhi kshamatva is ability to resist the disease or to fight with the disease. So by seeing this definition and by the analyzing the commentary of Chakrapani, now we have to think that is vyadhi kshamatva is immunity? What is immunity? We will see, then we will try to compare. Immunity is a, you know, immunity is the collective action of the cells, chemicals and process that function to protect body from the foreign antigens. When something foreign antigens enter into your body, it can be a microbe, it can be a parasite, it can be a bacteria or virus or whatever, or cancer cell or inner toxins, whatever. To protect your body, a collective reaction means from the cells, chemicals and different system get activated, and that is known as the immune system. Innate immunity is a, you know, represents the first line of the defense to an intruding pathogen. When pathogen comes in your body, that innate immunity will react to that, and it is antigen independent response. It is non-specific defense mechanism that is used by the host immediately or within hours of the encountering the antigen. When your body does not know what is the antigen, and without identifying antigen, the first reaction or first defense mechanism activated, that is innate immune system, whatever you have gifted to you from the birth. And the adaptive immunity, all the vaccines and other things also comes in this, or when you get infected with some diseases, then you get immune with that. This comes under this, and that is antigen dependent, antigen specific immunity. And that this immune system identify the antigen and immediately act and check it, so you will not get disease even you get infected. So that is adaptive immunity. The hallmark of adaptive immunity is the capacity for memory, which enables the host to mount a more rapid and efficient immune response upon subsequent exposure to the antigen. So, immunity refers to protection from foreign antigens, cancers, and certain toxins only. Vyadhi kshamatva refers to capability of your body to prevent the occurrence of disease, that is vyadhi, can be a niche or can be agantuj, means for external, due to external reasons or due to internal causes, and also to resist virulency of ongoing vyadhi. So concept of vyadhi samatva has a wider applicability, and so cannot be restricted to immunity only. Immunity, you know, it's only defense mechanism. But vyadhi kshamatva comprises both defense mechanism also, and to protect your body from you get disease at the first stage only, means you are not going to get infected once you have a good vyadhi kshamatva. So it's a broader term in comparison to immunity. What Charak says this is very much important nowadays, and we well, everybody means it is important for everybody to know about this, that na cha sarvani sharirani vyadhi kshamatve samarthani bhavanti. You know, many people gets infection and some people recovers very well, and some people don't get recover, or and some people succumb to it. What's the reason? This is the reason Charak has described very well, you know, that functional ability of the immune system is individual specific. Charak has further described two types of individuals, that vyadhi saha and avyadhi saha, depending upon their capacity to resist the disease. Vyadhi sahani iti vyadhi utpadak pratibandhakani. Chakrapani comments so that vyadhi saha, some people have a gifted immunity or vyadhi kshamatva. They can resist to disease. They are having a vyadhi sahatva, but some people are not having that capacity, and they cannot fight very well with the disease. Who are not able to fight? That also they have described, that sharirani chati sthula anyati krusha anya anivisht mansa shonit asthini durbal asatvam ahara upachitam alpa ahara alpa sattvani bhavantyani vyadhi asahani vipritani punarvyadhi sahani. Whomsoever are not having this, they are vyadhi sah, they are able to fight with the disease, but whomsoever these factors, they will feel difficulty to fight with the disease. So which these conditions are? Ati sthula, who are obese, excessive fat is there, for them it is difficult to fight with the disease, so they are vulnerable. Then atikrish, very thin and lean. Anivisht mansa, anivisht rakta, anivisht asthi, means their musculature, and then the circulation, and the structure is not well constructed, mean constructed body, or you cannot as a sturdy or stout physique is not there. That also they are also probable they may also get infection, and they may also not fight very well with that. Then durbala, who are weak. Asatmya ahara upachita, means which diet is not suitable to them, or which diet is not suitable according to season, they are taking that kind of diet, they also, their immune system also will be weak comparatively. Then alpahari, who are not taking proper food in the proper quantity, in the proper manner, all the things, but alpahari means taking very little food according to your digestion, according to your metabolism, and according to your require, you should take a proper quantity. If you are not taking the proper quantity, then your immune system, your vyadhi kshamatva is compromised. And then alpa sattva yukta, very important. Our previous speaker Kotecha sir very well described about this alpa sattva, and it is very important. If somebody has not having a very good sattva, very good control on the mind, and always fearful and very much stressed that what will happen to me if I get corona or any other disease, and then thinks a lot, then that compromises his immunity, and it will be difficult for him or her to fight with the condition. So but who are vyadhi sah, who are not having all these factors, they can very well fight with any infection. Their immunity is intact, and that they are vyadhi sah, they can fight with disease. So it is commonly observed that the certain persons do not develop a disease even after coming into the contact with specific hetus, means the reasons, while others becomes victim of the disease. Two or three people exposed to the same condition, but one get disease, one does not get disease. What's the reason? This is the reason, that some people are vyadhisa, they have a good vyadhi kshamatva, they have good immunity, they won't get disease. So immunity depends upon the maintenance of the equilibrium of dosha, dhatu, srotas, agni, everything, lot many factors. So it is not like that only one thing I am doing, I am sleeping well and then I have a good immunity. I am just taking one pill and I am having a very good immunity. No, it's a combination of all these things. You have to maintain the equilibrium. You have to maintain the dosha, dhatu and everything by taking the proper food, by maintaining the health with good sleep and avoiding all the causative factors and taking the drugs, rasayan drugs. That will maintain your immunity. Immunity means Vyadhi Kshamatva is described in the other meanings also in Ayurveda, like Bala, Ojas, Shlishma, etc. are also responsible for your Vyadhi Kshamatva, or it is used in the context of the Ayurveda, Vyadhi Kshamatva in Ayurveda. So Bala is prime and most in that. The concept of immunity in Ayurveda results around the natural inherent strength or power of the body, which is termed as Bala. And it has been described in Jvara chapter only, means in fever, when while describing the charak about the Jvara, how you will get recover from the Jvara, from the fever. There he mentioned that balas dhisthanam arogyam, have a good food, have a, you know, meat soup and ghee and everything, and have a good strength. And then if you have a good bal, good strength, good power, then you will get free of the disease. So he says that baladishtanam arokyam. It is your bal is very important to get free from the disease. And then he says the balam helam nigrahaya doshanam. Means if you have a good bal, it will check the disease. And if you have a good bal, you will come out of the disease. It will resist to the imbalance of the doshas if it takes place, and then it maintains the health. So Shushrut gave the in the detail what is the bal. So bal is sthiropachita mangsa sarvachesta apratikat apratihata shakti swaravarna prasada bahyakaran, all these things he has described. So if you have a miss this all, what is thiropachita mangsa and everything we have already talked about, but have a good voice and good complex, and your all the indriyas are working well, means if you have a good work, means karmendriya and gyanendriya, means your mental faculty, your physical all the activities is well coordinated, that reflects your bal, and you are to do able to do your every function with control physically and mentally very well. That shows your bal. And Charak has described three types of bal, that is sahajam, kalajam and yuktikruta. Sahaj means what you have got inherited, you have gifted at your birth. Prakrutam iti sahajam yat sharira satvayo prakrutam, and prakrutam iti janmadi pravrutam, that Chakrapani says, that whatever you have gifted by birth, that is sahaj bal. And it is hetvantara nirapekshat, means as you grow, it increases. It has nothing to do with anything. It is inherited, whether you eat or not, but it will be there. So dasyante hi kechita swabhavadeva balino dubalahascha kechita balavan, means some people you see that very weak from the birth, some people are very strong, that is sahaj bal. So if you have a sahaj bal, you need not to worry, you just maintain it and you will be able to fight. So genetic inborn resistance is there since birth to fight with the disease. It will increase with the tissue growth and affected by other factors, that is your sahaj bal. And if you have a good sahaj bal, you need not to worry. And tatra परीक्षण बलमांस शोणितो बलवान जाता रिष्ट सर्वे अपि शोषः लिंगे उद्रुत साध्य गेयः. इन निदान स्थान चरक सेज दैट इफ यू आर बलवान, इफ यू हैव अ गुड सहज बल, देन देयर विल बी अ डिजीज इवन एंड कॉम्प्लिकेशंस इवन इफ यू विल हैव, यू विल कम आउट ऑफ इट, यू नीड नॉट टू वरी अबाउट दैट. सो मेनी पीपल even needs a ventilator and then they come out of it. Many old age people or even with the comorbidity they come out of it due to this. Their sahaj bal is strong, their immunity is strong, inherited, then they won't get affected. Even your prakruti also depicts your bal, you know, shleshma prakruti shleshmalaha balvanto. Who are kapha prakruti, naturally they are having good bal. Pittala madhyam bala means who are pitta prakruti, they have a medium time of bal, and vata prakruti, they have to take care, they have alpa bal, and that's why they have told me that they are sadatura. And so whomsoever as with kapha prakruti, their immunity will be better, their vati kshamatva will be better, and vata prakruti, they have to take care of their immunity comparatively more in comparison to kapha and pitta prakruti. So this insight Ayurveda gives, and then on the basis of the prakruti one can decide that how much care I should take and what care I should take. This Ayurveda physician can tell you that what should be taken. And then Ayurveda has also mentioned about the, you know, about the bal, means adibal pravrutta diseases, means some diseases like meha, grahani, kshaya, all these things. Somebody has a madhumeha, means diabetes or cox and all that things, then they have to take care. Comorbidity well described in Ayurveda. Then sattvam manah manaso balam va yat utsah. What is the strength of your man? Sattva utsah, always bubbling with lot of enthusiasm, that gives the strength to your man, to your sattva, and it has an impact on your body, what our previous speaker Kotechasar was talking about. And Chakrapani, when describing about qualities of patient, there is abhirutvam gunaha. And Bhirutva is a Roga Kartutva. Bhirutva means somebody is fearful or having low sattva, alpa sattva, Bhirutva. Fearing by something means always fearful, what will happen if I will have a corona or something else? How will I get? What will happen to me? All these things has been considered as a, you know, reducing your immunity by Charak. And Charak has clearly said in Sutrasthan 25, where he has described all the things, breast, vishado rog vardhananam, if you are depressed, if you are not strong mentally, then there are chances that you will get disease, or if you have got disease, it may increase, intensity will increase. So abhirutva, don't be fearful, it is a quality of good patient. If you are fearful, then you have lost half of the war. So it is also important for immunity. Then kalajbal. First sahajbal, you can't do anything with that. It is gifted to you with by birth. But this kalajbal and yuktikutbal, you can achieve it by many different modalities you adapt, and then it can be increased. This kalajbal is also about the season, you know, uttarayan, from the you can say January to June, has been considered as adan kal by Ayurveda. Means gradually, naturally in your body, your bal, your strength, your power get lesser and lesser and lesser. Actually in grishma it is at the lowest level, where your strength is at optimum level in January. Same way from the July to, means when Dakshinayan starts, Visarga Kal starts, and in Visarga Kal, gradually your strength, your bulk gets increased, and at the November, December, it is at its optimum. So during November, December, January, February, you enjoy the maximum strength of your body, and rest of the time, there is in some time it's the middle, and in some time it is at the lowest. So in the June, July, it is at the lowest, we can say. So we have to take care during those days when your bulk is low, your strength is low due to season, your immunity is the at the lowest level due to season during this period. That also has to be considered. Then yuktikrita bala, yuktikritam punastad ahara chesta yogajam. What you are doing, yuktikrut means by different meanings, by applying your mind, by adopting certain measures, when you increase your immunity, increase your strength, that is called yuktikrut bal. First, they have so told that aharam mansa sarpirade means taking good nutritive food like ghee and milk and everything. Then cheshtaya uchit vishram vyayama yoga. So ahara cheshta yoga, uchit vishram, proper rest, vyayam, uchit vyayam means proper exercise, not moderate exercise, not excess. And then yoga. Now here yoga is ahara cheshta yoga, and anyetu yoga shabdena rasayana prayogam grahyanti. Yoga means here you can say yoga also, we can say yoga also. And Acharya says that yoga here you have to consider as a rasayana prayoga, rasayana chikitsa, for yuktikrita bala, for the bal you want to enhance your immunity, then you have to take rasayana. So this is acquired strength which is achieved or induced with the help of the dietary and other regime, that is with the help of rasayana, that is known as immunomodulation also. So these are the bal vriddhikar bhavas, has been described by Charak. We will see in the detail that balvata purusha deshe janma, whomsoever has, means where you have taken the birth, that also makes importance. They have said that Sindhu deshe, they are balvat desha, means in the Punjab, in the Sindh, who are born, they are usually having a very good physical strength and good immunity, that we also know very well. Then balvat kale janma, the birth taken means birth during the balvat kal, means in hemant and shushur, during shishir, during November, December, January, February, if somebody is has born, usually their body constitution will be strong. Then period of life which is natural strength offering, sukhakar kala yoga, that in your yavan, in your young age, maximum bal you are having. Then the bijguna sampat means depends on your genes. Then kshetraguna sampat, that when the pregnancy was taken place, what was the strength of intrauterine, that makes a lot of difference. Then ahara sampat, what diet you are taking, that also makes difference on your bal. Then sharir sampat, well built body, that is vadisa or avadisa, that already we have looked at that. And then satme sampat, if you are taking a compatible diet, means shada ras yukta ahara, if you are taking, then you are getting the proper nutrition and your bal will be there, your immunity will be at the peak, at the optimum. Then sattva sampat, and healthy mental status. Only physically you are strong and you are mentally not strong, that's not going to work. And svabhava samsiddhi, some have, you know, some, if it refers to the person engagement in the strength increasing measures. And other way you can say svabhava samsiddhi, some people have inherent bal. Then yovanam, that already is there. Then the karma, vyayamadi karma, karma abhyas also provide you a bal. And lastly, Samharsha, they have mentioned. If you are happy and contented, cheerful, satisfied, santoshuk, then you have a good immunity power. If you are worried, if you are stressed, if you are depressed, that has an adverse impact. So this was about the bal, and it is also one type of immunity. And then another concept in Ayurveda about the Vedic Samatva is Oja. Oja actually has been described as the, you know, sar of all dhatu. So Shukra has been considered as Oja. And if you have a good Oja, Ojas is the supreme glow of the health of all tissues. And if you have a good Oja, then if you have a good bal, it maintains the, you know, life of living being. While it is a vital factor, it maintains homeostasis, controls on the working of the body, normal functioning. It's responsible for your normal functioning, and then by its presence, the body is sure to survive. So Oja is also important. If Ojokshay is there, you will get disease. So which are the factors which are responsible for the lowered immunity? Age means older you are, the chances of the lower immunity you have. Then in the childhood also your immunity is building up. So at that time also you are vulnerable. Then if there is an intercurrent illness, that is also a reason for the lower immunity. Then malnutrition, if you are taking some drugs which may lower the immunity. Then irregular intake of food or taking food before previous meal digested, habit of day sleep, excess everyday alcohol drinks, excessive exercise, excess of fear, hunger, grief, greed, all these things are overwork. All these things are responsible for lowering your immunity. And what can be the answer if you have to build up the immunity? And the answer is rasayana. What is rasayana? I think I need not to tell detail about this rasayana. Rasayana is, you know, it's a ras means all this. It includes all dhatu, and ayan means proper circulation. Rasayan therapy, it improves your, you know, essence of all your dhatus. So ultimately it increases your bal and your oj, and hence adhik samatva and immunity. Obtaining the optimum nourishment to each dhatu, rasayan will do this thing. Many drugs are there, we will see. And rasayan is defined as a therapeutic measures which promotes the longevity, prevents aging, provides positive health and mental faculties, increases memory, and impart resistance and immunity against disease. So how rasayan works? It nourishes rasa, like ashwagandha and milk and ghee. This, you know, food and herbs increases the rasa dhatu, and rasa dhatu is a is the first dhatu. It nourishes all the deeper dhatus and becomes a precursor to all dhatus in nutrition. So this nourishing rasa dhatu will increase your immunity, increase all, means nourish all dhatus, and your immunity will be intact. Then increase in agni. Pipali and ginger and other drugs are responsible for this agni. If your agni, your metabolism is intact, then you are not going to get disease, your immunity will be intact. And the cleansing of the channels, all the srotas shodhan, like garlic and pipali, are responsible to cleaning these srotas and cleaning all the channels, enhancing the, you know, circulation in the body. And so it is important for the nutrition and all the things, and it, hence it increases the immunity. So rasayan can work as a preventive measures, like Guruji, Haridra, Draksha, Pipali can be taken as a preventive, particularly if you consider the COVID, where the rasva srotas and pranava srotas are involved. These drugs are very helpful in that. Then curative, for curative, Jwarahar and Kashashwashar rasayan should be taken, like Guruji, Nimba, Kalamegha, Punarnava, etc. And for rehabilitation, after the recovery, Agnidipan and other dhatu restoring drugs should be there. That is like Rason, Amlaki, Draksha, etc. Many work has been done, many paper has been published on this rasayan drugs, like Harikaki, Amlaki, Punarnava, Guruchi, Shatavari, Manduparni, Rasana, and number of drugs are there which are avoiding the Rasayan effects. It depends on the physician and condition of the person, which Rasayan is suitable to him. But I think Guruchi, Amlaki, and Ashwagandha, all this Rasayan are common, which can be good for every condition. Many papers had been published. I think we are running short of time, so I would like to conclude in brief that Guruchi, I need not to tell much more about the Guruchi. In IPGT and RA also, a study has been done on the Drosophila, how it enhances the life of Drosophila, how it is a rejuvenative, and how in the KEM also, many years back, the study has been started about its immunomodulatory effect. And many papers are there about the Guruchi, that it is a wonderful Rasayan drug. Then the Amlaki, it is also well accepted. Chyawanprash, everybody knows about it. And many works has been done about this lipid peroxidation effect, and then ROS production activity on Capase-3. It is working on apoptosis, increased cell viability, level of antioxidant enzyme, cytochrome cooxidase, and mitochondrial membrane potential has been increased by Amlaki. Many studies are there. It has an immunomodulatory activity, Amlaki Rasayana. Dr. Subhash Lakhotia has also worked on Drosophila with this Amlaki Rasayana and has proven it is a Rasayana effect. It enhances the longevity, and it is also having a cytoprotective activity and immunostimulant. Haridra, worldwide, lot of works are there about this anti-inflammatory effect, antioxidant effect, anti-cancerous activity, and anti-HIV activity. Our Ministry of Health has also advised to take a milk with Haridra every day to improve your immunity, and it is a simple but very effective measure. Then Pippali, well known for increasing the bioavailability in your body. If it is attached with any drug, suppose it is given with the Guruchi, it will enhance the bioavailability of Guruchi and increase the Agni, improves your metabolism, and it is really good for immunomodulation. Then Rason means the lehsun, garlic, you know very well. And that is also useful. It has been advised by Ayush very well about this, that use this garlic in your daily food, use Haridra in your daily food, that will increase your ability. Again, the immunity, Draksha, that particularly this Munakka is a renowned immunomodulator drug, anti-aging effect, and it works, means it is working as angiotensin converting enzyme and antibacterial effective. Many papers are published on the Draksha. It has again advised by the Ayush Ministry to add in the Ayush Kwath, which Ayush Ministry has advised. So Rasayana works as antioxidant, anti-stress, anti-inflammatory, cytoprotective, adaptogenic, immunomodulatory. All this impact are having with Rasayana, and so every day one should take any of the Rasayan which is suitable to us according to our Prakruti, according to season, that will protect you from many things. It works as an immunomodulator, it enhances the proliferation of lymphocyte, stimulation of cytotoxic activity and phagocytosis, and activation of the macrophages for enhanced generation. Many ways Rasayan is working on all the infection. It increases your immunity, and Vedic Samatma, one should take Rasayan regularly to fight with COVID and current situation. So Vedic Samatma is a very effective tool. One should focus on that. And Rasayan is the tool to increase your Vedic Samatma. And lastly, I will say, with all these drugs and everything, your with diet and your day-to-day sleep and everything, exercise, Achara Rasayan is also important. Achara Rasayan means your behavior and ethics is very important for your mental peace, and it provides a strength to you. So that is also important that I want to convey. Only drugs, Ayurveda is not about the only drugs. Drugs are part of it, but Ayurveda is about your behavior, your mental health, is about your diet, it's about your exercise, it's about your sleep. Everything it covers, and together all, builds your immunity. So enjoy good immunity by following Ayurveda. Enjoy your Vaidik Shamatva by taking the Rasayana, following the guidelines of the Ayush, and stay healthy, be fit, and fight with the COVID with Ayurveda. These are the some action I would like to share with you. Gujarat Ayurveda University, Gulabpur Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya, and APJ Tindare together fighting with the COVID. We have a Dhanvantri Rath in Jamnagar. We have started we are outreaching to the people to advise them about Ayurveda, to the police, to the Jamnagar Municipal Corporation, to the medical college, to the collector office, everywhere, who are the highly vulnerable people who are in the fight of the COVID. To them we have the given the drugs for the immunity, Sanshamnivati and all these things. And then we are also having a clinical trial in the medical college to see the impact of the Ayush 64 as add-on therapy. So we are working a lot, together and to for the benefit of the society. And we are trying to serve the society to protect them from the Ayurveda very well. So at the last, we can say that with the help of the hammer of the Vaidik Shamatva and Rasayana, just you break down the flu and fight with it. And I wish that everybody will get benefited with this ancient wisdom of Ayurveda in this tough time. Thank you all for patience hearing, and I'm thankful to Gulabpur Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya and his team for giving me opportunity to share my views about Vaidik Shamatva and Rasayana with you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing the importance and significance of verity in Ayurveda, what we have understood in the form of Vaidik Shamatva. You have very rightly said, sir, and you have briefed very beautifully in your presentation also. You shared some of the thoughts of vision and mission of Government of India, working towards the betterment of this particular COVID-19 situation. You highlighted something about the balance, homeostasis and the equilibrium to maintain in this very situation. And I'm very much thankful to you for highlighting the in-depth knowledge of classical understanding of Vaidik Shamatva, the contemporary view of current scenario. And last but not the least, you also highlighted about the Gujarat Ayurveda University outreaching towards the public and showing the best possible benefits which can be given to the public. Thank you so much, sir, for delivering your talk on this very topic. Thank you so much. Please be with us for the question answers after the third guest finishes his talk. Moving ahead, humanitarian assistance is about providing life-saving medical help to the people who require it the most. Yes, I'm really honored to present in front of you our third guest of today, who is a renowned practitioner and academician in the field of Ayurveda from Goa. I welcome Vaidya Upendra Dixit, sir, to deliver his talk on the topic Atayik Chikitsa in Ayurveda. I request Dikshit sir to please present his talk. Sir.
Vaidya Sushant ji, am I audible properly?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Respected Vaidya Koteja ji, I think he is engaged in some other important works. Respected Vaidya Anup Thakur ji, respected Vaidya Pandbhat ji, and the organizing team, and all who are watching this program. It's really my privilege to speak at the Hirak Mahotsav of this esteemed institute, Gulab Korba Ayurved Mahavidyalaya. And my today topic is Atayik Chikitsa in Ayurveda. I think you can watch my presentation.
Yeah, yes, sir. It is.
Presently, I'm working in my own clinic, but previously, I have worked as head of department and professor in Ayurved College at Goa and Ayurved College at Gadhinglas district, Kolhapur. And this is our website. Atharvaveda says that Ma Bhider Na Marishyasi Jaradashtim Kronomitva. So these sages, they are saying that do not fear, you will save your life and you will not die. And this is a painting from Ashtangruday. Etati Mrittu Pashanam Akande Chedanam Dudam Rogottrasita Bhitanam Raksha Sutra Sutrakam. It is said that
sir, you are not audible.
I think the chit sir has got disconnected.
Shushant bhai, some connectivity issue.
Phone
is connected. Yeah.
We are trying to connect with Dr. Dikshit sir. He is having some connectivity issue. Please bear with us and we remain in the session. Arpan sir, by the time Dr. Dixit connects with us, can we take some of the question, if you permit?
Yeah, okay, but then there is only Thakur sir with us at this moment of time, I understand.
Yes, sir. Dixit sir, you have connected, but if it is possible, can you please? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yeah. You are visible, sir. Your video is on. Can you hear me, sir? Dixit sir, am I audible to you?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Please. Yeah, you can restart and share your presentation, sir.
हाँ, अभी दिखाई दे रहा
है? नहीं सर, अभी तक तो आपका स्क्रीन शेयर नहीं हुआ है।
हाँ, लेकिन वीडियो दिखाई दे रहा है मेरा।
यस सर, यू आर विजिबल, ऑडिबल भी है सर। Yes, sir.
Abhi.
Your slides are visible. Yes, sir.
Visible.
Slides are visible, sir. Yes, sir. Slideshow pe aap karke. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. So it was a little technical problem. American Coil of Emergency has enlisted 1,733 emergency condition. We can understand that it is a vast field. So what is the application, sir? Atyay is Vinash, and Atyay means Atyo Vinasho Bhavati Asmat Ityad. Atyayik Avastha means which can lead to death of a person. And another important thing which is said by Hemadri is Yat Karyam Kala Pratiksham Na Sahate Tad Atyayikam. So therefore, kala pratiksham na sahate. In atyayik chikitsa, we have to act swiftly. Instantaneously, we have to take a decision and act. Because there are such conditions in which sudden death of the person may occur. Our tests describe various references, not only about atyayik, but about anatya and niratya. They have described that how to perform panchakarma and other treatments without producing atyay, and which are the food or other medicines which will not produce atyay. That way they have described the things. Atyay chikitsa is a vast field to study, and I am just giving a summary of the topics which should be studied to understand atyayik chikitsa in Ayurveda. First of all, prana shabdenu nirdishta bhava. In the text, certain factors, certain body constituents, they are described as prana, like dvadasha prana and other factors. And certain other factors, they are described as prana world is attached with them, like Pranava Srotas. So in emergency, we understand that Pranava Srotas needs to be protected first. So just by adding the word Prana, they have indicated that to save the life, this Srotas is most important. Like that, the Prana word is attached with certain factors, and that guides us about the emergencies. I'm not going in details of each of these factors in details. Next is Marma and Marma Dhat, and Satya Prana Marma are most important, and how to protect them, and if Marma Dhat is there, how to treat that. And for that purpose, the nine Siddhisthan in Charakamrita gives guidelines about it. Specifically, three Marma are mentioned, and they are most important. While treating emergencies, effects of are also very important, and therefore other chikitsa, which is sometimes neglected by students, is very important field in emergency treatment. Ojakshay also lead can take in emergencies, and therefore ojo rakshan and sadhya ojo vardhan, instantaneous increase in oj, is very important to save life. Maintaining bala and increasing bala immediately is also important in emergencies. Protecting agni is also very important even in emergency condition, because it is told that shante. Protecting indriya is also another important aspect, because it is told that semriyam chetanam dravyam. Atma leaves the body and death occurs, but we cannot know about how Atma is leaving the body or whether it is leaving or not. But we can observe indriya, and from that we can get an idea about the chetanatva of the person. And therefore, indriya are very important. And sahasa indriya nash, suddenly when particular indriya stops functioning, then that is indicative of some arishta. There are certain diseases which are described as pranahara, like jwara, shwar, thikka. They are very important, and in atyek chikitsa, we should be looking after closely for these diseases. Especially jwara is very important, and it is told that jwara appears at the birth and death of a person, and therefore treating jwara is very important. In this regard, to save life of a person, it is important to learn samnipatik jwara chikitsa. The Bhartri have already given how to treat samnipatik jwara, but that latter text, Vangasen, Bhav, Prakash, etc., they have given details of treatment of samnipatik jwara, and they are very important for us. Especially now in this pandemic, again, what we observe is that shwasa in jwara, this condition is described in this text. How to treat that? For that, they have given the details. All such vishadhanya jwara, their details are also given in our texts. When visha enters through nasa, then which specific symptoms are observed? When visha enters through throat, skin, then which specific symptoms are observed? All these details are given in Sushrut Samhita, Dallantika, and other later texts. What is important in the treatment of these diseases is that the visha, it destroys oj, harms the dhatus, and produces dhatu pak. And this is very important. What we observe in the patients of also, as per the scientific articles which are available about the ICU patients of corona patients, it is observed that from our point of view, dhatu pak takes place, and therefore renal failure and multiple organ failure occurs, and that leads to death of the person. for Visheshanyajwara, the texts have described very specific yoga. For example, for the Visha, which enters into the body through Nasa, they have described a Sarvagandha yoga. To avoid Dhatupak, we find that specific care is taken in these texts. For example, they have described to add Dhamasa, Bhukshura and Kantakari to the food of the patient so that the Mutra Pravritti will be properly maintained, Pak will not occur. Similarly, various yoga which are mentioned for the treatment of these Vishajanya Jwara and Sannipatik Jwara, for example, Dwatrimshat Kwath, in all such Kwath, they have added such medicines which will prevent Dhatupak and which will maintain Mutrapatti and Jwara will be also cured. So with such measures, we feel that even in emergency patients of Corona, our Ayurvedic treatment will be very helpful, although we cannot make any claim unless we actually treat and show the results. But our medicines like Swarna Sindur, Mahalakshmi Vilas, Kalyan Sundar, and if there is Anubandha of Aam or if the Pramana of Kapha is more, then medicines like Swarna Samir Pannak or Hemi Verbal, they can help in such patients. It is that regular use of Swarna will not allow Visha to produce effects on the body. In very critical conditions, Hemi Verbal or Trailokya Chintamani like medicines can be very helpful. And in acute conditions where Jwara and Dhatupak is taking place, Jainangal Ras can be very much helpful. Also in Sannipatik Jwara Chikitsa, the yoga which are mentioned in Charak Samhita, like Shatyadi Varga, Bruhatyadi Gana, they are very important. And we feel that with such treatments, the proper function of lung and other organs can be protected. Whether these medicines can actually destroy the virus, that needs to be seen. That can be known only when these medicines are actually used. So presently we cannot any claim, but still we should make study that whenever required, we can make use of such medicines.
आवाज स्पष्ट असं तिथून फोन आला जामनगरवरून जवळ
सो तू बोलते
सुहागचा फोन आला तुम्ही बोला का सो अक्का माझ्या तू काय जवळ
संन्यास संन्यास इज अन इम्पॉर्टंट कंडिशन
कॅन यू हिअर मी
प्रॉपरली हॅलो
Yes, sir. Absolutely, sir. Please go ahead.
Okay. No, we can hear you properly, but please shut off the another microphone which is on. That is creating echo. It is in the same room where you are speaking from.
I had moved. I am okay.
Now. Like it is told that Sannipataja Visarpa, it is Maha Atyek. Specific conditions of diseases are described in the text which can lead to Atyek Avastha. Shroto Vidya Lakshan. And Vyapata Panchakarma, these are certain areas which are very important to understand Atyek Chikitsa in Ayurveda. There are very few books to guide about Atyek Chikitsa in Ayurveda, and all of them have made good efforts, but in certain books there is only translation of some modern conditions. So up till now what I have found that the series of articles by Vaidyaraj Vinayak Mahiskar, which was published in journal Ayu, Atyek Chikitsanam Tattu. That is the best to guide about Atyek Chikitsa according to Ayu. So I wish that this series of articles will be translated in Hindi and English, so that others who do not know Gujarati also can understand about Atyek Chikitsa in better way. I had an opportunity up till now to treat around 140 patients who were on the verge of death in various ICUs. Various vaidyas will be having their own experiences about how to treat such conditions. But as per my experience, because these are the modern ICUs mainly, and they allow us to treat such patients, that is a good thing. But they will not allow all our treatments like Panchakarma there. So what usually we are doing, that we are using Pottali Kalpana. Pottali is navigated on a specific navigation stone, jaise chandan ghisa jata hai. And that is applied to on the gums of the patient. Even if the patient is unconscious, there is no need to swallow. And the person, he will not swallow, it will not enter into the respiratory tract, and it will be immediately absorbed from there, and immediately it shows the effects on the patient, like good improvement in the respiratory rate, in the pulse rate, in oxygen saturations, and that immediately we can see on the monitor. Well, most of the patients are on the monitor. So in these conditions, according to Ayurveda also, there can be consideration of sadhya sadhyatva. Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes,
now, sir. Okay. So in these conditions, according to Ayurveda also, there is sadhya sadhyatva. But even those patients who are according to Ayurveda also asatya, in those patients also, when this Pottali are applied on the gums of the patient, instantaneously there are changes. The patient patients who were in the coma, they many of them became conscious. They later on could have food, they could swallow the food, they got good appetite, good sleep, they could talk to their relatives, and some of them who were according to Ayurveda also in Atyek Avastha, they died peacefully after that, after some days. And those who are according to Ayurveda, in them Arishta Lakshan or such other Asadhya Lakshan were not observed, those patients, they survived for longer period, for few months or even for few years. Therefore, this treatment is very effective, and only in those patients in whom we could not apply this medicine on the gums, but such patients, they died, but in other patients, at least temporarily, the life of the patient was saved. And in those patients who were not asadhya as per our consideration, they survived for longer time. So that's why this treatment is very effective in these patients. So according to my guru, Vaidyaraj Gautam sir, three medicines which we should always keep with us. They are Hemagarbha, Trailokya Chintamani, and Sutshikar. They are most important medicines in treatment of Atyek Avastha. And each of these medicines, they are having their specific mode of action, and that we need to understand while using them in our practice. For example, Hemagarbha, it performs Chedan of Kapha, and therefore Margavarog Janyavat, in that it is helpful. But since it contains Suvarna, even in Dhatukshaya Janyavat also it can help. In Trailokya Chintamani and this Hemagarbha activates the indriya and man, buddhi, etc., and therefore chetanatva is maintained or it is regained. In those patients, Trailokya Chintamani, it is a wonderful medicine in Dhatukshaya Janyavat and Margavarog Janyavat. In both the conditions, it acts similarly and very effectively. And in Suvarna Sutshikhar, it acts when there is पित्त प्राधान्य स्पेसिफिकली साम पित्त एंड अनुबंध ऑफ वात धातुक्षजन्य वात एंड मार्गवजन्य वात बोथ एंड इट इज ऑल्सो कफन सो इट इज त्रिदोष शामक मेडिसिन lot of things can be explained about these three medicines and their uses in specific conditions and lot of cases also can be told about them in the patients who are having visaujnyata now in the text saujnya nash visaujnyata etc various words are used to describe these conditions so the patients who are unconscious and some of them who are in coma there are certain medicines which I have tried in lot of patients and I have found them effective like hemagarbha trailokya chintamani suvarna sutshekar siddha makarjwaj swarna sindur brahatvat chintamani yogendra ras sahasrakuti abrak all these medicines there are a lot of other medicines but these medicines were most commonly used in my practice of, while treating such patients and therefore I have mentioned them and as you know there is rasayog sagar so there are a lot of other medicines which we haven't even tried yet so all these medicines they are very very much effective in these patients so our teacher Vaidyaraj Gautam used to say that we should be ready with one ayurvedic emergency kit in which these medicines which are very potent some people will ask the question that why only rasaushadhi see I am talking about only those conditions in which the person is on the verge of death and at any moment the person may die in such conditions it is important that we should have very potent medicines and rasaushadhi are very potent and kalpa of rasaushadhi they are even more potent because in them sanyog shakti and sanskara shakti both are added and that's why they are very very potent and therefore they are required in such conditions so we should be ready with such potent medicines and it is like investment for us even if they are costly we must keep them with us and because they will not be spoiled they can be kept over the years they can be kept for lifetime or for generations with us and we don't know what time emergency may come and in that emergency we cannot search for the medicines so we should be ready with them so all these emergency potent medicines should be with us specifically the potali there are a lot of potali which are available like hemagarbha potali potali of sut shekhar potali of basanta kusumakar suvarna malini vasanta and so on so we should keep them ready and a lavigating stone and madhu honey should be kept ready and many of these medicines like hemagarbha or trailokya chintamani they are given with ardrak swaras juice of ginger a few drops are added to it therefore ardrak sattva like we should keep ready in a bottle with us because at the last moment we cannot search for ardrak and take out juice from it when the patient is in dying moments so all these kits should be ready and immediately we will apply these medicines on the gums of the patient now when the patient is totally under our treatment suppose he is in ayurvedic hospital or we are alone treating him then there are a lot of other methods which we can use for him like even anjan or pradhamannasya or many other applications of various medicines on the forehead or on the spine or a lot of other treatments can be used in such patients but for that we should have our own emergency treatment hospital in ayurveda probably maybe initially in collaboration with some modern doctors who are experienced in emergency treatments so we should have such emergency kit ready now various acute and critical conditions also come across in the practice and I'm just mentioning some of them so that the students who have newly started practice they will be encouraged I had an opportunity to treat over 70 patients who had 104 or 105 degree temperature and the temperature came down successfully below 101 degree Fahrenheit within less than 20 to 30 minutes. In more than 200 patients who had Schwass vague, like in layman's language, they were treated successfully and within 20 to 30 minutes their Schwass vague was brought under control. There was no need of any inhalation or any injection in all these patients. In more than 39 patients who were having hiccups continuously, in some of them for one week, 2 week, 3 weeks, in all such patients, their hiccups stopped immediately within 30 minutes. And this was in all the patients, this was observed. There was no failure in hiccups. In all the patients, this was observed. In Atisar also, with our medicines, immediately with her first dose or with within one or two doses, the motion can be immediately stopped. And I had an experience of treating 110 patients of cholera and gastroenteritis, and their swabs were taken in laboratory, they were tested, and their motions were not stopping with modern medicine that time. That was around more than 25 years back. So with two doses of one specific Ayurvedic medicine, the loose motions immediately stopped. That I had an experience in that. Now, considering the time limits, I will present only one case here in Atten Avastha. That was a person in coma. His condition only I will present. There are a lot of cases cases are there to present. The first case which I had an opportunity to treat was a mother of a very well known practitioner here, a senior practitioner here in Goa, modern practitioner. And his mother, she was in coma since 4 days after the paralysis attack. And although he was a modern practitioner, but he had faith in Ayurveda, and he knew that there are certain medicines in Ayurveda which can help in such conditions. So he approached me and he told that I have heard that there are such medicines in Ayurveda. So can you help me in that regard? I have heard from my gurus about the effects of these medicines. But unless we use actually them, we feel that this is some exaggeration about these things. So that's why I was also not knowing that exactly what will happen. But I was having faith in Ayurveda, and I had Hemagarbha Koktali with me. In the night, around 11:30, I started giving this medicine to her. That means it was applied on her gums. And after 2-3 doses, she was sitting in the bed in the early morning. And later on, she was able to talk with her relatives, take the food properly without a rice tube. And she survived for many days. So like that, there are a lot of patients, and even certain patients, I had an opportunity to treat them in the Goa Medical College Hospital. For example, mother of a well-known politician in Goa, she was also having a brain tumor, and in her last report, they had mentioned that certain contrast studies and further studies are required, but in the wake of prognosis, we are not doing these studies. So in such a condition, when we started our treatment with Trailokya Chintamani, she regained consciousness. Now in her case, the sister who was looking after her, she was not knowing how to exactly apply on the gums. So they were giving it to rice tube. But still, within 1 or 2 days, she regained consciousness. So it is also observed that when it is applied on the gums, quick effects are observed. And when the medicine is given through rice tube, then the effects are a little slow. So that lady also survived for some days, but later on, due to cardiac arrest, she unfortunately died. But through all these treatments, even the modern doctors here, they came to know that, okay, Ayurveda also can do something in such conditions. And it was, they were generous to give us permission to treat these patients also. That is also a good thing. Now, I will present a case. A patient on 29 January this year, he approached the relatives approached to our clinic, 68-year-old male patient. He was having hypertension since 10 years, alcoholic liver disease with liver cirrhosis, and he also had history of adenocarcinoma of stomach, and he had chemotherapy in 2014 for that. And he was chronic alcoholic since 25 years. And 3 times a day he was having drinks. And in December 19, he had first seizures, and he was taken to Goa Medical College Hospital, and he had a stroke, and he had a 6.3 into 3.4 into 4.8 centimeters hemorrhage and a clot in the brain. And he became unconscious. He was treated in Goa Medical College Hospital, and his condition improved a bit. Then later on, he was discharged, but again his condition deteriorated, and he was in coma when we actually started our treatment. He was totally in coma. He was not responding to any response, any stimulus, or even to pain. And there was no movement at all in his body. So we started our treatment. A brief history was that he was getting repeated jwar and shushka kas, and after he got the stroke, he had already he had kriyani, but after getting stroke he got sarvanga kriyani. That means even both hasta and pad, he could not make any movement of that. So this was the condition of that patient initially, when he's totally unconscious, he's not responding to any stimulus. So that bear with the quality of the video, because it is taken by the daughter of the patient, and she wanted to tell about some swelling on the abdomen. That's why she is showing that part mainly. Now, considering the condition of this patient, we started with a specific medicine called as Sutendra Rasayan initially. That is just like Suvarna Sutra Shekhar, with addition of certain other medicines, and that was given 3 times in a day. And now for this patient, because the patient was at home, he was totally on Ayurvedic treatment, and therefore whatever effects are there, they are only with Ayurvedic treatment, because there are other patients in whom the modern treatment also was going on, and along with that Ayurvedic treatment was given. So in this patient, now that he was totally under Ayurvedic treatment, and therefore whatever is the credit, it goes to Ayurveda for that. So with initially this treatment, and he was taking it at home, and therefore it was advised that they will give the medicines through Ryle's tube. So it was given through Ryle's tube, and Amalaki, Rakta Pachak and Dhamasa. In many organs, their utpatti, Rakta is very important. In Sushruta Samhita, they have described the utpatti of avayav, and therefore Rakta Pachak helps a lot in these patients, and this Rakta Pachak also prevents Dhatu Pak. It is an experience, and Amalaki. And they are also helpful for Pachan, Anuloman of Vat, etc. That's why they are given in Apanakal, so that they will make Anuloman, and also Vikrut Pitta will be moved out of the body. And in this case, since he was having all these conditions due to Madhyapan and Sachetu, this Vikrut Pitta was very important. Then another combination of Tapyadi Loha, etc. was given. This Tapyadi Loha, because Indriya are also very much linked with Rakta, it is in Ashtang Sangraha, it is told that Mahabhutanam cha prasadat and Raktavahi srutam prasadat Indriyani, like that they have told. So Indriya are also produced, there is relation of Rakta, therefore Tapyadi Loha helps in such conditions. Swaranaraj Mangeshwar will not allow Dhatu Pak, and it will instantaneously increase Bala and Oj. And Haridra Ghana was given because it will perform Pachan in Rakta, and therefore this Grathita Rakta which was there, that will be removed, and also Rakta Stamban will also take place at the same time. And Rasa Sindur was given to instantaneously increase Bala and Oj, and also it will help to remove that Grathita Rakta. So all this combination was given, and since it was given through Ryle's tube, usually in other patients when it was applied on the gums, instantaneous results are observed within 1 or 2 doses. The patients even become conscious. But when it is given through Ryle's tube, it takes little longer time. And in this patient, the patient was very much weak, and because of all these diseases and because of Ati Madhyapan, he was so much weak that his bala was also very, very less, and that's why it took little longer time. That means right from the second day, he was showing little bit improvement, but after a few days, that means about 5 or 6 days, he became conscious. So this was his video afterwards. And this patient is now conscious, and now he is trying to talk with his daughter, as you can see. And later on, he started taking food orally, and he is telling about his complaint. If he is getting pain or any other complaint, he is telling about all these problems. And now, as you can see, this is starting of July. Still that patient, now this patient, in medical college, it was told that our medicines are not working now on him, and his condition is deteriorating, and you can keep him home, and only symptomatic treatment you can continue, because there are not many hopes that life of this patient can be saved. But not only the patient became conscious, but he is very much alive and improving still. This is in July now. So from this you can understand that with Ayurvedic treatment, how the life of the patient also even can be saved in such patients. So considering the time limits, I have not presented many cases also with associated with each of the topics which I mentioned under the consideration of Atyak Chikitsa. There are a lot of cases related to each topic, and about the use of specific medicines also, there are various cases which can be told about that. In many of the cases, we are having the records of the patients. In some of the cases, we are having videos of the patients. And in certain cases, we do not have the records because the modern hospitals, they allowed us to enter and treat, but they did not provide us all the record. And even if they will provide the record, they will not enter into that this Ayurvedic medicine was given to them. But for such patients who were treated separately by Ayurveda, we have got all the record with us. So you can understand that Ayurveda is having even the potential to treat acute and emergency conditions and such patients who are on the verge of death. And as a future of Ayurveda, which is the theme for today's presentations, this aspect, emergency treatment is Ayurveda, is also very important, and therefore we should treat the patients. And when we treat emergency conditions, then the patients have respect for Ayurveda, then they give equal position to Ayurveda as compared to the other systems of medicines also, and therefore Ayurveda will be gradually becoming the mainstream medicine. If you want to have that, then emergency treatment in Ayurveda should be developed, and therefore this kind of treatment is very important. Therefore I have presented a few things about emergency treatment, and I am very much thankful for the organizers to providing me an opportunity to speak in front of you. And I wish that Gulabpurba Ayurved Mahavidyalaya will make further progress, and this is an esteemed institute in Ayurved. Thank you very much for patiently listening.
Thank you so much, sir, for the kind of presentation you have highlighted in this very session. You have rightly and very briefly highlighted very important yet very significant points related to the Ayurveda emergency treatment. And very truly, you have shown us that the today's theme, what we have kept as an Ayur vision, how much truly you have devoted yourself towards the treatment and management of such a patients. And you have proved that yes, to all the extent, Ayurvedic treatments can be very beneficial, provided if used in a very safe and proper hands. You have highlighted many points regarding to the importance and consideration of pranava srotas, trimarg, and significance of ojakshay. You have highlighted, sir, regarding the clinical studies under the acute and chronic conditions with the approach of Ayurvedic medicines in regards to the emergency management. You have highlighted some of the herbal mineral preparations in the form of trailukya, chintamani ras, effect of certain other herbal mineral preparations, and their role in the dhatu pachan. Sir, at the end, I would like to thank you for the true value of your practice towards the Ayur vision, and you have truly occupied the space of today's theme, sir. Thank you so much, sir, to be with us, and I really appreciate your work towards the betterment and development of Ayurveda. Thank you so much, sir. Moving on with our program, as we are lacking the time slot, with the permission of the organizing chairman, we have decided that we'll not be taking the question answers right now, sir. What we have decided that we will email you the questions which have been asked by some of the users, and as per your convenient time, if you can please send us your answers, your interpretations will be very helpful to us, sir. So without further ado, I request our organizing chairman to kindly give away the thank and thanks the speaker who have presented in the session. Vedi Arpan Bhatt, sir.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sushant. For all the viewers and the listeners, I think that this session had something to take away with them or to keep back with them, you know. Usually, there are so many aspects. Okay, so now it's okay. So there are so many such aspects which about Ayurveda which people have dilemma about or do not have a very clear understanding about. And I hope we were able to clear certain aspects out of them. One was related to the psychotherapy or manochikitsa with regards to such epidemic, pandemic or endemic conditions, because that is the time when the bulk psyche is disturbed and then that again keeps on disturbing the psyche of others. Then the second aspect was regarding the immune system and boosting of immunity through certain Ayurvedic aspects which we call rasayan, because rasayan also is very popular word among people, but they actually don't understand what rasayan should actually mean or how that should be really used. So we had some clear understanding about that. And last but not the least, we had a very wonderful presentation regarding emergency treatment in Ayurveda. Not only we had a good presentation, but along with the name of the drugs and the mode of utilizing those drugs, and with documented results. So that was a wonderful aspect on the whole, which we had about some questions regarding Ayurveda which people don't have clear answers to or don't have clear understanding to. So I would like to thank all the three speakers. First of all, Honorable Secretary Ayush, Padma Shri Vaidya Rajesh Kotejaji, for sparing so much of time for us. I know that was for his mother institute also, but being at a key post and being able to spare such an amount of time, actually I would like to thank him from the bottom of my heart. And on behalf of the institute, I would like to thank our Honorable Vice Chancellor and Director IPGTNRA Vaidya Anup Thakurji for again sparing his time. You know, all these chairs are very important so far as the time is concerned. So thank you very much, Anup sir, for sparing your time and having a wonderful presentation. And last but not the least, I would like to thank Vaidya Upendra Dikshit ji for giving us a wonderful exposition of emergency treatments in Ayurveda with proper examples, and also showing us the videos and citing the exact names of the drugs, you know, which is actually very rare. People don't give up the names of the drugs. They say that they have treated, but it is very hard. So thank you once again. I would like to thank all the viewers and all the people who have been with us in thick and thin. We had some disturbances in between today, but I thank every one of you for your patience and your goodwill and your love towards this session, towards this institute. Thank you one and thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir, for winding the session. And last, as our chairman has already said, that this particular session is ended over here. And just to remind to all the viewers that this particular session is getting ended over here, but the celebration continues. And for today, please, all the viewers and the participants and the speakers, I request everyone to be a part of another session what we have today evening, that is specifically Ayurveda in Global Perspective. We'll be having some of the international speakers who are actually the past students of our institute and the work they are doing in the respective countries. They'll be highlighting the work and they'll be sharing their views with us. And the program would be is scheduled for today, that is 5 to 6:30 p.m. That will be live on YouTube and Facebook. So I request all the viewers to be a part of this. And tomorrow we'll be having a exclusive session, morning 10 a.m. to 12 p.m., which will be specifically with the experience sharing by the alumni of Sri Gulapur Ayurved Mahavidyalaya. And on the same day, tomorrow evening, we'll be having alumni cultural event. That would be 4 to 6 p.m. So I request all the viewers, participants to please be with us, attached with us, and give us more enthusiasm to work for the betterment of Ayurveda. Thank you so much, and thank you one and all for this particular session. Thank you.